Thanks for inviting Arc Biodiversity and Climate. We're pleased and surprised that you've invited us, because ours is not a thing. It's a method. It's not a product. It's a way of thinking. And it's designed to optimise the whole of the built infrastructure for ecological functionality and for resilience for people and wildlife. And so we call this method Shaping Better Places, and it's three simple decisions, and it's no more or less than a to-do list. Do one thing, things get better. Do two things, things get very much better. Do three things, everything changes. Horizons broaden, opportunities pile up one on another, and that's exactly what is required. If we're going to get anywhere near the requirements upon us, we have to have this systemic change across all of our built infrastructure. So what does this mean? What do you have to do? The first decision is to deliberately go about building fully functioning ecosystems in the built environment. We can make the built places we make for us function fully as ecosystems for the natural world, in the places that we inhabit. Why wouldn't we do that? It doesn't mean your building is going to fall down. It doesn't mean your loft is going to be full of bats. It might be. It doesn't have to be. It doesn't mean your garden is going to be full of nettles. You don't need that stuff. We can be sophisticated about making the built environment functional for wildlife. Fully functional, not expedient, not purely decorative, fully functioning ecosystems in the built environment. Once you decide that, all sorts of other things happen. That's the first decision. The second decision, having decided that, is to look at the unit, the quantum of your development or infrastructure. There might be a single wall on a building, a single building in a plot, a single plot in a neighborhood. It doesn't really matter. Start with the quantum of development and look from top to bottom at opportunities to intervene. You don't have to do everything everywhere. Just change certain things where you can. Could be a window box, could be a street planter. A street planter can be a fully functioning ecosystem if you want it to be. So look for these punctuated interventions in the built environment, from top to bottom. That 200 meters of our domain that we build is exactly the same as the natural world. High level migrations aside, the daily operation of the natural world is within that scale. Why wouldn't it be? We're medium-sized wildlife building habitats very badly for ourselves. The natural world responds in the same way. We're looking for punctuated interventions. And the third and critical thing is to pattern repeat. Once you have built this cluster of ecological intervention, a planter and a window box, a roof, a wall, a piece of greenery, fully optimized for ecology, you repeat at a meaningful distance. 100 meters, 150 meters, 300 meters, 500 meters, by which I mean that the wildlife you build up in one place will find the next. And the space in between becomes enriched and enlivened without you having to do anything. You can come back to those spaces, fine, brilliant, absolutely fantastic. But you can patch your way through your built environment, building up spikes of ecological density that communicate. Your green roof talks to the landscaping below at this point. They are saying the same things. You're providing life cycle resources, breeding, feeding, hibernation, overwintering, pupating, display. All of the requirements of wildlife built in to the infrastructure we create. It has asset resilience, it has psychological resilience, it is necessary work. And we can leapfrog our way. It may be within your red line still, but it may not be. The next thing in this zone of intervention may be a school or a church or an abandoned piece of public land, and you as an infrastructure delivery organization will be communicating with a new audience beyond your traditional stakeholders. By taking this approach, your legacy in effect ripples out beyond you. Pattern repeat is crucial. And by doing these things, we're in the last minute, your built environment outperforms in terms of its environmental qualities. You're faster through the planning system. No rafts of awful planning conditions because your application wasn't good enough to start with. You're building conversations with the community that hosts you and your infrastructure. And you're increasing investor confidence because they are going to be asking these questions. How are you going to do this? How are you going to deliver these resilience requirements? It can be done by following those three steps. Thank you very much.